We're going to do that same thing. We're going to be bouncing back and forth between Exodus 29 and Leviticus 8. So remember to keep your places there. Now, we're talking about the consecration of the priests. And again, we're not just talking about Old Testament types and pictures. We're trying to get a grasp on what those shadows meant and what they're trying to say to us today and how we live, how we function, because we're the true priests, or at least we're supposed to be. And so we need to know this more than these priests in the Old Testament did. And here we have these guys that are being consecrated, Aaron and his sons. And this is taking place by Moses, and this is a very solemn thing, incredibly important, and yet it's just a shadow of what we're supposed to be about and what the real thing is about. You know, before I go on any further, I'm blessed by all the people that are here. I can't believe two people are even here. Cassie had a wisdom, one pulled or several? Wisdom tooth pulled, and Jennifer didn't have anything pulled. So, I'm blessed that you guys would even... there you go. Amen. Well, I may be the wrong man for that. But. All right, so to catch up now on this, what we've already seen is we've seen the three phases of washing, anointing, and clothing, and we've seen the reality behind that. And we've already moved into the three offerings. We've dealt with the first two, the sin offering and the burnt offering. Remember, this class isn't on the offerings. This class is on the consecration of the priests. And what we're getting to do is we're getting a more clear look at these three offerings in the process. And some things that I didn't get a chance to cover at all last time, when I did cover the sacrifices, I got into the burnt offering and spent, I guess, the whole time on the burnt offering, it seemed like. I never even got out of that. Well, we will get into now this class a little bit in relationship to the peace offering, which I think is an incredible, incredible offering. So let's go to, if you're not already there, Exodus 29. And we're going to start in verse 19. And thou shalt take the other ram. What other ram is he talking about? Well, there's already been a ram that was taken for the burnt offering and a bullock for the sin offering. And thou shalt take the other ram, and Aaron and his sons shall put their hands upon the head of the ram. Then shalt thou kill the ram and take of his blood and put it upon the tip of the right ear of Aaron and upon the tip of the right ear of his sons and upon the thumb of their right hand and upon the great toe of their right foot, and sprinkle the blood upon the altar round about. Thou shalt take of the blood that is upon the altar, and of the anointing oil, and sprinkle it upon Aaron, and upon his garments, and upon his sons, and upon the garments of his sons with him, and he shall be hallowed. And his garments, and his sons' garments with him. Also, thou shalt take of the ram the fat and the rump, and the fat that covereth the inwards, and the fat above the liver, and the two kidneys, and the fat that is upon them, and the right shoulder, for it is a ram of consecration. And this is important. It is a ram of consecration. And one loaf of bread, and one cake of oil bread, one wafer out of the basket of the unleavened bread that is before the Lord, and thou shalt put all in the hands of Aaron, and in the hands of his sons. And thou shalt wave them for a wave offering before the Lord, and thou shalt receive them from their hands and burn them upon the altar for a burnt offering, for a sweet savor before the Lord. It is offering made by fire. All right, we'll stop right there. And now go to Leviticus chapter 8, keeping your place, of course, in Exodus 29. Leviticus chapter 8. And let's start at verse 22. And he brought the other ram, the ram of consecration. So here in both places, it is called this the ram of consecration. And Aaron and his sons laid their hands upon the head of the ram, and he slew it, and Moses took of the blood of it and put it upon the tip of Aaron's right ear and upon the thumb of his right hand and upon the great toe of his right foot. And he brought Aaron's sons, and Moses put the blood upon the tip of their right ears and upon the thumbs of their right hands and upon the great toes of their right feet. And Moses sprinkled the blood upon the altar round about, and he took the fat and the rump and all the fat that was upon the inwards and the fat above the liver and the two kidneys and their fat and the right shoulder, and out of the basket of unleavened bread that was before the Lord, he took one unleavened cake and a cake of oiled bread and one wafer and put them on the fat and upon the right shoulder. Let's go ahead and read into verse 27. And he put all upon Aaron's hands and upon Aaron's son's hands and waved them for a wave offering before the Lord. And Moses took them from off their hands and burned them on the altar upon the burnt offering. They were consecration for a sweet savor. It is an offering made by fire unto the Lord. And Moses took the breast and waved it for a wave offering before the Lord. For of the ram of consecration, it was Moses' part, as the Lord had commanded him. And so we begin to see, since you read that, and that's sort of a copy of the other one, but go back to Exodus 29, and let me see, we started in verse, 19. And we see that there's actually two rams that are offered. First there was a bullock, and then there was a ram for the burnt offering, and then there is this ram of consecration, and that's what it's called. And this is really important because this is the consecration of the priests. And it's very important to realize that by the time we get to this third offering, that we are moving now away from just dealing with sins. We're moving away from just dealing with identification truths. We're moving into actual consecration. Now, that's an interesting word because a lot of times when you hear people talk about consecration, they'll say, okay, you need to consecrate yourself. Come up to these altars and dedicate yourselves to the Lord. And usually dedicate and consecrate mean the same thing. So you come to the altars and you consecrate yourself, and you know, or you consecrate yourself to the ministry, or you consecrate yourself to witness more, you consecrate yourself. We're always consecrating ourselves to all these things, and yet the real deal is a consecration in relationship to this ram. It is the ram of consecration and your relationship to it. And so it required not just a ram of burnt offering, but a ram of consecration. Again, they put their hands on it, but this time for a different reason. Because this time they are going to, and we'll get into all this later, but they are going to relate to the offering the way God relates to the offering. It's completely different. Completely different. Up before this time, it was Jesus dying for sin, and then it was Jesus dying for the Father. Right? I mean, one's dying for sin, the other dying for... But now, there is going to be an involvement, a consecration, and with that, an involvement with the Lord in his offering. So they're putting their hands on the offering for a completely different reason than the other one. One place, this is called the peace offering also. And so it is, this peace offering is being slain, this ram of consecration. And it all follows the pattern of the peace offering also. And so the hands and the peace offering, the laying on of the hands and the slaying of the peace offerings is now God's own people that have a heart after him are sharing in what he's doing, the giving of his son. They're sharing in it. There are, and we will see, we didn't read it, right down to eating it, which we'll get into later. And so the ram is put on the altar, part of it, and part of it is held back for the priest to eat. And the Bible says that God is a consuming fire. And the fire of God comes down and it consumes or it eats up. And there is this communion that's taking place because they are eating their part and God is eating his part. This is not, you know, usually when you hear the phrase, and that's fine, usually when you hear the phrase, God is a consuming fire, there's only one aspect of that in our mind. God's going to rain down fire on us and destroy us. That's the deal. That's usually what we think of. God's a consuming fire and he's out to destroy us. But God consuming the peace offering is him hungrily eating it up and fellowshipping with us in that as the priests also eat of that same offering. And they're sharing in this thing together. So, you know, each one has their part in this communion. Each one has their place. So, the concept is this. Both eat and subsist of the same offering. They live by lamb. God is living by that lamb spirit. And they are eating and living by the lamb. They're taking it in. And so, let's face it. With the sin offering, many have experienced salvation. And by the sin offering, they have experienced the wonders of God forgiving us. And of God saving us from hell, and of God saving us from punishment, and of God saving us from sin. But this offering, there's so few that come to this place where they want to eat what God eats. They want to live by the same thing that God lives by. They want the lamb as their sustenance also. And so, the last sacrifice here that is given is this ram of consecration, because consecration is your involvement, your dedication to it, not God's. God's been dedicated to this thing from the beginning. God dedicated himself. Jesus dedicated himself to die for us. Jesus dedicated himself, you know, consecrate. Let me just use the word consecrate. Jesus consecrated himself to die for us. He consecrated himself to live for the Father and to do what he did for the Father's sake, just because it was he wanted to please the Father. Well, we know Jesus is consecrated. But this is speaking to our heart. This has gotten to a level where we've taken in an awful lot from the Lord. And now it's time that we sit down with him and start partaking of the thing that is important to him. Again, keeping your place there, but let me show you a scripture over in Numbers. Numbers chapter 6. This is actually right after the consecration of a Nazarite, which is very similar to the consecration of a leper, which is very similar to a consecration of a priest. Yeah, and we'll get into some of that as we go here. But then there's this benediction afterwards, after the consecration has taken place. And it's in verse 22, number 622. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, Speak unto Aaron and unto his sons, saying, In this way ye shall bless the children of Israel, saying unto them, The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. And they shall put my name upon the children of Israel, and I will bless them. This is a blessing because he's putting their name on the children of Israel. It's as if he's marrying them, and they're taking his name, and with it comes his blessing, and all the blessing that comes to God comes to us, and all of the relationship now, we've entered into something deeper than just being a dedicated Christian or deeper than just trying to follow him. We have become one with him, and we are honored of him as if we were his own. And he said to the priests, I want you to do this. This is what I want you to do. I want you to bless the children of Israel in this manner. And so the dedication is given, and this benediction of peace, of a peace offering, as it were, is put upon them. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. And that last little phrase there is Jehovah lift up his face upon thee and place upon thee peace. And of course, there's peace with God once, after the Lord shows us his face and we begin to be changed into the same image of the one that God is at peace with, Jesus. We're at peace with God not just because he made peace with enemies. We're at peace with God because the Lord lifts up his countenance upon us and we're changed into that same image and we become one and we begin to be considered as one and they shall put, and talking about the priest, they shall put my name upon the children of Israel and I will bless them. That's, if nothing else, that's the heart of the Lord. That's the heart of the Lord. And again, we can grasp doctrines and concepts and we can talk about deep things and we can talk about all these ideas, and yet the one thing that he wants us to grasp and get hold of is his own heart for us. He can make promises to us, and those promises will fade and we will fall into fear or we will fall into doubt unless we know his heart. He can say these kind of things over, these benedictions over us. And we can hear it, and it can only be a momentary blessing as we receive it at that moment. Because we're receiving something he's saying instead of the heart that's saying, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And so because we're blessed at that moment, we keep looking for circumstances and times and events with the Lord that get us by and get us over and that make us excited or make us feel peace again or make us whatever, instead of realizing that same heart that set it at that one time. And if you look back through your life, you'll remember the time the Lord moved there for you and it was really powerful and it really helped you. And then he moved later on in your timeline and it really helped you and blessed you. And he moved another time or gave you a word or did something, or over here he did a miracle. And in all of those things, instead of gaining from that this is the heart of the Lord each time, that's the way the heart of the Lord is, what we do is we gain an experience from that. And then when we're down and out or feeling bad or whatever, we start looking for that experience again, not believing the heart of the Lord for us. There's a phrase that I've said, never doubt in darkness the things that you've seen in light. Because let's face it, when you see it in light, my God, there's victory, you know. There's such overwhelming victory and joy and peace when we see it in light. The goal is not to have us back in darkness again and God to come shine the light again. The goal is to realize that the light in His heart always shines for us. And, you know, I mean, could you not say, is there no greater proof than the cross itself? Is not the cross valuable 24 hours a day, every day of the week? And to say, you know, that's, you know, there's the symbol. If you just see a cross, a symbol cross, there's the symbol or the token of His incredible love, of His incredible care. And folks, really, honestly, the only thing He really requires from us is faith, or what? Come on, what is that? Believing His heart. Really, I mean, it's not just believing His word. It's not just believing what He says. It's believing from whence it came. Because let's face it. I mean, you know, 25, 30 years ago, you know, 40 or 50 years ago, certainly here in Texas, if somebody gave you their word, you wouldn't have to sign a contract. And that was a fact, especially in Texas. You would not have to sign a contract. If they gave you their word was their bond, and that was good enough. But what if somebody comes along and he's a shyster and he gives you his word, but then he rips you off? What is my point of even saying that? My point is, the word is only good as good as the person who gives it. So there has to be some sort of a comprehension of Jesus beyond His words, beyond the scriptures. And I'm not saying we go beyond the scriptures. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that the scriptures have value to us because we treasure the true treasure. The scriptures aren't the treasure, folks. Christ is the treasure. Then the scriptures declare His heart to us and declare things to us until we can get to Him and know Him and hear Him. And you know what it's like when He speaks the word to you and it is straight from His heart. It is so real, not because of the content alone, but because He would say those things to you. We are in ourselves rejects. We are in ourselves, we are rejects. We are not worthy of anything. No, we are worthy of death. We are worthy of hardship and frustration. We are worthy of all, you know, whatever we get. You know, I mean, we were talking about this today a little bit, Nisi and I, and when we were eating just before we came here, and talking about the price of gas. And how everyone's here is just freaking out. Well, when Deb and I were missionaries back in 1972 in Jamaica, the gas was $2 a gallon in 72. In most countries, it's way above what we're paying now. I think she said in Japan, it's the equivalent of $10 a gallon, you know. But we don't live like that. We expect everything to be a certain place and a certain level for us. And I want you to know something. You know, you heard about American Airlines and what they're doing and all the, you know, all the stuff. I mean, it's just going to get harder and harder. But have you ever heard of tightening your belt? Yeah, it's a common thing, and what it means is you ain't going to be eating as much. You know, you're not going to be consuming as much. And this country is a country of consumers, not givers, but consumers. And, you know, that's what Adam is, so it's not, Adam is not necessarily American. But Americans sure let him rip. They sure let him go, you know, and it's just the truth. Folks, we may start entering into just some of the hardships that people with less around the world have been enduring for a long time. You know? But is not the Lord still wonderful to us and merciful to us and kind to us? And can't we trust that the Lord's going to take care of us, and we can't take care of ourselves? We never could. Maybe we thought we were. And maybe he has to pull the rug out just to show that, you know, to show what? Number one, or not necessarily in order, but to show that we're not taking care of ourselves. But number two, or maybe number one in order, is to show that it was always his desire to take care of us, to be there. It is his desire. And that when the going gets rough, that's when you look deeper. You look deeper. All right. So I this phrase, I looked it up, and it says, Jehovah lift up his face upon thee and place upon thee peace. And again, the New Testament equivalent of that is, when he lifts up his face upon us, we are changed into that same image from glory to glory. Folks, it is from one glory to the next. It is, or another translation says, an ever-increasing glory. Paul said, I have not yet attained. How many of you have? You know? But there is, as it were, a promise with the looking into his face of an ever-increasing glory. Can you believe it? Can you believe it? Can you believe him? All right, so let's look in, it moves to another point here, and over in, back in Exodus, again, Exodus 29. There is the placing of the blood that we read about, and I think we read all of this, but you know, it's in Exodus 29, beginning with verse 19, and certainly with verse 20, where verse 20 says, thou shalt kill the ram and take of his blood. And this is very, very, very significant. Just those words right there. I don't know that we always comprehend as quickly. Thou shalt kill the ram and take of his blood and put it upon the tip of the right ear of Aaron and upon the tip of the right ear of his sons and upon the thumb of their right hand and upon the great toe of their right foot, and sprinkled the blood upon the altar round about. And thou shalt take of the blood that is upon the altar and of the anointing oil and sprinkle it upon Aaron and upon his garments and upon his sons and upon his garments of his sons with him. And he shall be hallowed, and his garments and his sons' garments with him. Over the course of some 40 years of serving the Lord, I've heard a lot of different teaching on this thing about the tip of the, you know, and the blood and all of this stuff. But it occurred to me recently as I was studying this that they're not consecrated here by the blood of a sin offering. This is the blood of a peace offering. This is the blood of the one we're going to eat and commune with the Father in. peace offering, maybe more than any of them, represents Melchizedek and his priestly ministry, the communion priest. You shall take of the blood of the ram of consecration. You shall take the blood of the peace offering, and put it on your ear and upon your thumb and upon your toe. You walk and you listen and you work always with the blood of the peace offering upon you. Not your sins have been forgiven. You're way past that by the time you get here. You are not a sinner anymore. You are becoming a priest of the Most High God. He's not thinking about your sin right now. He's thinking about you and him, and you're communing together in what is important to him and bringing that to the people. So you are only consecrated as a priest by the blood of a peace offering. Consecrated as a priest. And we're all priests of God, folks. That's why it's so important to understand what just happened to us. And I'm not going to get fully into this because someday I will go back and I will be able to share out of the sacrifices and be able to cover this, where I have a lot more information than I would share tonight anyway. But the blood is taken and put it on the earlobe of the right ear. And all hearing now, by that blood, all hearing is in connection with this lamb that we're going to eat and live by, that we have peace with God. All hearing is only in connection with Christ and Him crucified, the sacrifices. See the blood? All hearing now is not connected to a million subjects in a million areas. Your hearing is directly tied to Christ and Him crucified. And it's applied to the sacrifices. Or you could even say the sacrifices are applied to your hearing. So from them, from the priests, they would hear the fullness of Christ in His self-giving nature. That's what they hear. That's what a priest is consecrated to. Can I get an amen? That's what he's consecrated to. His whole life is going to be around sacrifices. His whole involvement is going to be with that. His ear has been circumcised. It is no longer just an ear that has discernment. It is an ear that has circumcision. It is an ear that has had the cross, not just the sin-bearer cross, but the self-giving one that we're going to be partaking of with God, eating the same meat, the same meal. We have an altar to eat of which they know not of. And so, that's just one aspect. But it's all tied in to the hearing of the Melchizedek priesthood, or the hearing of the communion that priests have with God. Not just communion. Well, I can commune with God. I'm walking in the woods and I'm communing with God. Oh, I'm communing with Him over His nature. Folks, priests are not communing with God over nature. They are communing with God over His nature. Nature is a shadow. His nature is forever. But they're not just communing as meditation and contemplation. That's not the right communing. Communing is fellowshipping. It is eating together the same thing and communing over it with God, what it is that's important to him. All right, and then I found the notes that I was referring to some time ago when I mentioned that their garments were, they were sprinkled. And we read that. They were sprinkled with blood and a mixture of anointing oil, and they had white linen. Their garments were white, pure white linen. And then Moses came up and sprinkled blood and oil spots all over. And so, and of course the sprinkling is also of peace offering blood. Not just for sin, peace offering blood. And you're not just anointed, you are consecrated, because this is the final portion here of consecration. Coming up on the fact that the last thing left is going to be nothing short of just sitting down and eating with God. So I'm going to read the notes because I made some reference to this before and shared some on this. Your ministry as priests must give equal place to the poured out life as well as to the anointed life. You know, because the anointing was there. Now, some of you have probably not read it, but I've written an article on the anointing, and I refer a lot to Christ, which means what? The anointed. The anointed. But nonetheless, there is an equal balance here of the crucified life with the anointed life. You want to know why big televangelists and leaders and all this fall and fail? And because they don't have the balance of the cross with the anointing. All right, so even perfectly clean, fine linen is made what God wants by washing. Now I'm going to quote Revelation 7:14. You don't have to turn there, but it says this: they have washed their robes of righteousness. They have washed their robe. Just consider that phrase. They have washed their robes of righteousness, because the robes represent the righteousness of the saints. They have washed their robes of righteousness and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Does that even make sense? The priests are standing there in robes, crystal clear, clean and white. And Moses comes up and washes them, putting the blood and the oil all over. Picture what that looks like. And then we find the true fulfillment in Revelation. They have washed their robes of righteousness. Well, if they're all white and they're righteous, what are you doing washing them? Well, what was once naturally white is now spattered with spots of blood and oil. In our eyes, a mess, but in God's eyes, now it is truly washed clean. Not because of sin. This is not the blood of a sin offering, folks. The cleansing is the cleansing life of Christ. Did you know that your blood cleanses you all the time? Did you know that? Not just, I know you wash outwardly, but inwardly you are washed and cleansed by a flow of blood that cleanses your system and takes out impurities and, What the priest ministered in and walked in, their garments, was a visual lesson to all who saw them, and a visual lesson of the truth. We do not just preach forth his excellency, but we show forth his excellencies. That's in 1 Peter 2:9. And that's the true translation of that, and you can look it up. That we are to show forth, the way it reads in your King James is, we are to show forth the praises. check it out. It says we are to show forth his excellencies, the things that are excellent about him, the things that are glorious about him. We're supposed to be showing those, not preaching forth. That's why I wrote it the way I did. We are not just preaching forth. Well, I know you have not yet attained. But there has to be a desire to press on. Because if there's no desire to press on, when you haven't attained and there's no desire to press on, then what do? You quit. If you have not attained and there is no desire to press on, you will quit. Where must our faith lie? Can't be in ourselves. It can't be in ourselves. Because you are headed down a road of despair. And despair can lead to depression. And depression can lead to, shall we go on? There's one simple answer to this. And I say simple. I say simple. I say it's simple because the concept is simple. Yes, I admit it is hard to get your eyes off of your failures sometimes. Yes, it is hard to pick up and keep going sometimes when you see how far short you come of this glorious Jesus that, you know, I mean, it's so funny because in one breath I can say, well, you know, in my 40 years of serving the Lord, but in light of the Ancient of Days, 40 years is just, it's barely a little piece of spit out of his mouth. It's just nothing. It's just nothing. And in light of him who is all glorious, well, if nothing else, you could look at that and get discouraged. But you have to realize it's not by might, nor by power, but by his Spirit. The Holy Spirit is your friend. The Holy Spirit is your companion given to you by the one who loves you. The Holy Spirit is the one who gave you the Holy Spirit to keep lifting him up and keep you moving forward, just like Eliezer did with Rebekah leaving Haran, leaving her country, leaving her kindred, and coming into an identity that is not her. It is a true leaving. And if you do that and you make that journey, you will do nothing short, nothing less than what Rebekah did. You will leave your old place and your old identity. You will leave it as sure as Rebekah did. You will leave it. And you will be brought into Isaac's tent. You will be made one. And you will have truly new life. But you got to make that journey. You've got to let Eliezer keep you pointed in the right direction. What did the writer of Hebrews say? So lift up the countenance that has fallen and the hands that lie, that are, you know, and run the race with patience. It's, you know, in a church service or a Bible school setting, that may sound like a glorious, victorious trumpet sound. But in fact and in real life, It's a must, and it has nothing to do with jumping and shouting. It's got everything to do with just putting one more foot in front of the other for Jesus' sake in the gospel. So, these priests, I see them coming out afterwards. All the families waiting, wives are waiting, grandkids are waiting, all this, you know, everybody's waiting for the priest to come out, and here they come out all spots and blemishes. And yet, to God, these are not, this is the cleansing. The spots and blemishes were us in our natural whiteness, in our natural goodness. You know, some people are they have a air about them of natural goodness. They're just good people, you know. That's why a lot of just good people gravitate to being a Mormon or something. I mean, it's a good life. I don't see too many of those kind of people here, but there are people like that. But just as surely as the rank sinner has to give up every ounce of his identity and life, so the good person does too. I'll never forget Blaine Bartell used to, I think he had this teaching that was to teenagers. The girls used to be involved with his ministry and stuff. And he put out a video that says, why good people go to hell and bad people go to heaven. And if you think, I mean, at first you might go, what? But then you realize if you're going by your own goodness, guess where you're heading? But it is the truth that God saves those who know they're a mess. God helps the weak and the outcast. He does. He does. He does. Jesus did it when he walked this earth. Who was drawn to him? It was the outcast and the people that no one else cared about. But when Jesus spoke, somehow in his words, they found hope. Whereas when the Pharisees spoke, they felt condemnation and hopelessness, and that probably drove them from going to the temple as they should, or the synagogue as they should, because all they got was condemnation. But when you hear that Christ is the answer, Christ is the life, and my identification now is with him, there's a cleansing of your mind that begins to take place. All right, how much time we got on that thing? 12 minutes. You know what? I'm going to stop, because a lot of times I wait and then we get back late. And so I'm going to go ahead and stop, and we'll come back in about 10 minutes.